Hello guys, I hope you all are doing well. Let's start with today's topic, which is the end of first chapter.
If you see NCERT chapter 10, you will see how the boundaries of the Mughal Empire were reshaped by the emergence of the number of independent kingdoms, and how this NCERT says that by the first half of the 18th century, this has started being, and in 1765, how another power, the British, had grabbed successfully major chunks of the territory in eastern India.
Similarly, if you see the crisis of the empire and the later Mughals, this NCERT covers even that. And after that, we proceed towards the emergence of the new states and the decline in the authority of the Mughal emperors. So this, if you see, would be your old Mughal provinces, that is Hyderabad and Awadh and Bengal, and then we have the Jagirs of the Rajputs. Then we have the independence, how Sikhs got their independence, how Marathas got their independence, and accordingly how Jats even got their independence. And this would end the 10th chapter. This is NCERT class 7, chapter 10, and the first chapter of modern India is chapter 10 of this NCERT, and this covers in just every small point. And when you are reading the chapter along with it, go through this NCERT, and thus you will complete this chapter of your NCERT too. So let's begin with our chapter. See, when the Mughal era ended, not as in the complete era, but after Shah Alam II that we have, we see that yes, things were breaking down. The political system, the economic system of this empire was breaking down, and there was a trend of large number of independent and semi-independent powers such as Bengal, Awadh, Hyderabad, Mysore and Maratha kingdoms. And it is these powers which may be characterized as succession states. So what is this succession state? See, states where the rulers are ruling in their way. However, the name is from the topmost authority. The name is from the center and not just of the state. That is called succession state. That the virtual exercising of the autonomy in matters of execution and powers is at the local level. Nothing apart from that. So they arose as a result of the assertion of autonomy, and states were product of rebellion. So there were succession states. There were states like Maratha, Afghan, Jat and Punjab. They were the product of rebellions by the local chieftains, zamindars, peasants against Mughal authority. And then there was of course also a third zone comprising of the areas of south, west, southeast coast and of northeastern India, where Mughal influence had not reached in any degree. So rulers of the 18th century tried to legitimize their position. Moreover, nearly all of them adopted the methods and spirit of Mughal administration. Good. Then first group of states inherited functioning Mughal administrative structure and institutions. Okay. The rulers of these states established law and order, viable economic and administrative structures, curbed with varying degrees of success, lower local officials and petty chiefs and zamindars who constantly fought with higher authorities for control over the surplus produce of the present. And then they also conciliated and accommodated these local chiefs and zamindars who desired peace and law and order. In general, there were, in most of the states, decentralization of political authority with chiefs, jagirdars and zamindars gaining in economic and political power. Politics of these states were invariably non-communal or secular, and the motivations of their rulers being similar in economic and political terms. However, these rulers did not discriminate on religious grounds and public appointments, civil or military, nor did the rebel. So these are the advantages of the state, the succession states, the different types of states that were emerging. So these were the good parts of this. They were following and everything. But what were the bad parts? What were the consequences of these states that were emerging? See, none of these states succeeded in arresting the economic crisis which had started in the 17th century. Remained basically rent extracting states, and zamindars continued for their oppression, and condition of the peasantry continued to deteriorate. Even tried to promote foreign trade, but they did nothing to modernize the basic industrial and commercial structure, and this explains their failure to consolidate themselves or to ward off external attack. This is the advantage, the disadvantages, the analysis of the rising of the semi-autonomous state. Then we have Hyderabad and the Carnatic. See, state of Hyderabad founded by Nizam-ul-Mulk Asaf Jah in 1724. This paragraph completes what all was the story behind that. How did Hyderabad emerge and everything? He never openly declared his independence from the central government, but in practice acted like an independent ruler. Just what we wanted to know about what is succession state. Then waged wars, concluded peace, conferred titles, gave jagirs, everything. Everything was followed as an independent ruler, but he never declared his independence. So, and then there was another part that is Carnatic, one of the subas of the Mughal Deccan only, and as such came under the Nizam of Hyderabad's authority. But just as in practice, Nizam had become independent of Delhi, and the Nawab Sadutala Khan of Carnatic had made his nephew Dost Ali his successor without the approval of his superior, the Nizam. And later, after 1740, affairs of the Carnatic deteriorated because of the repeated struggles for its Nawabship. And thus, we'll see the Carnatic Wars that happens. We'll see the Anglo-Maratha Wars. We'll see Anglo-Mysore Wars in our next video. And then we have Bengal here. With Bengal, what was the story? It started with Murshid Kuli Khan, who was made the governor of Bengal. He established peace by freeing Bengal of internal and external danger. Then Murshid Kuli Khan affected economies in the administration, reorganized the finances, fresh revenue settlement, granted agricultural loans. Now again, this is an important word. Takavi is granted agricultural loans. Then system of revenue farming led to increased economic pressure on the zamindars. Collected the revenue from the zamindars and the peasants with utmost cruelty. This was bad part of him. Equal opportunity for employment, good. Expansion of trade, good. Encouragement to all merchants, goods. Regular thanas and chokis. Control over the foreign trading companies and everything. Bengal Nawabs proved, however, to be short-sighted and negligent in one respect. What? They did not firmly put down the increasing tendency of the English East India Company after 1707, failed to see the English company was no mere company of traders, but they were representative of the most aggressive and expansionist colonialism of the time, lack of contact with the rest of the world. So I would say the internal issue that they had in that, the problem was the cruelty part, the oppression part. But apart from that, why East India could come into Bengal was the first thing that, yes, they actually did not focus on that English East India could be more than what they were showcasing. And then they did not have the contact with the rest of the world from which they could know about their oppression. Then neglected to build a strong army, again another part. And then they failed to check the growing corruption. So this were the disadvantages of Bengal. Then Awadh, founder of Awadh, was Saadat Khan Burhan-ul-Mulk, appointed governor of Awadh in 1722. Extremely bold, energetic, iron-willed, intelligent person, but refused to pay the land tax, organized own private armies, defied the imperial government, succeeded in suppressing lawlessness, discipline, big zamindars, and thus increasing the financial resources of his government. Saadat Khan carried out a fresh revenue settlement, good, and then levying equitable land revenue, protecting him from oppression by the big zamindars. And he too did not discriminate between Hindus and Muslims. Troops were well paid, well armed and well trained. Administration was efficient. Continued the Jagir system and everything. He was succeeded by his nephew Safdar Jung. And then this is the map here. And then we have here the paragraph again, which is continuing about the Awadh part. And then Safdar Jung also organized an equitable system of justice, impartiality in the employment. So basically what you'll see, there are some good points like revenue settlement. This is there in Bengal also. So there are some points which is common in every part, like you'll see employment or land revenue settlement, or you know, the cruelty part, or equitable system of justice is one thing. So you need to take out the unique feature of every part and the common feature that there was. Then prolonged period of peace and of economic prosperity in the resulted in the time in the growth of a distinct Lucknow culture around the Awadh court. And then patronage of the arts and culture, handicrafts. Awadh was also known for this. And then Nizam-ul-Mulk, Murshid Kuli Khan and Ali Wardi Khan and Saadat Khan, Safdar Jung were men of high personal morality. Lives give light to the belief that all the leading nobles of the 18th century led extravagant and luxurious life. What was the problem? It was only in their public and political dealings that they resorted to fraud, intrigue and treachery. And this is what took them down. Then we have Mysore next to Hyderabad, most important power emerged in South India. under Hyder Ali. Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan are the most important personalities under Mysore. And then what do we have? See, Hyder Ali was uneducated but keen intellect, man of great energy, daring, determination, brilliant commander, shrewd diplomat, found his opportunity in the wars which involved Mysore. And then we'll also see how he took into the fight, recognized the advantages of the Western military training, established a modern arsenal in Dindigul, and then efficient administrator, and then religious toleration, and everything that you know, you would want to know about Hyder Ali is here. From the beginning, he was established in the power. He was engaged in wars with the Maratha Sardars, Nizam and British. He repeatedly defeated the British forces and reached the walls of Madras. However, he died in 1782 in Battle of Portonoro in the course of Second Anglo-Mysore War and was succeeded by his son Tipu. Then Sultan Tipu, complex character, innovator, new calendar. Then system of coinage, scales of weights and measures. Weights and measures is an important part in our constitution also. Then personal library was there, interest in the French Revolution. He planted a tree of liberty at Seringapatnam, became a member of a Jacobin club. Everything, these are good points of Tipu if you want. If you can see the back of this book, assess character and achievements of Tipu Sultan. So these are the ways UPSC also asks questions, not just this simple and this direct, but obviously linking it up. But this gives us a viewpoint of how we should be studying these pages. See, character and achievements of Tipu Sultan. So once you assess the character, you'll know what all the he was an innovator, a new calendar that he brought in, and then system of coinage. He showed a keen interest in the French Revolution. He planted a tree of liberty. So all of these are things that you can add and make your answer enhanced. And after that, after this paragraph, we again have here a little point. See, Mysore flourished economically under Hyder Ali and Tipu. And after that, these are the two quotes that I would say, if you know, if there are questions relating to this, we can put it down in our answers if we want, and if that answer is relatable to these quotes. Then, in fact, alone among the Indian rulers, he understood the importance of economic strength as the foundation of military strength. So these are the relation of Tipu. And then this ends the Tipu Sultan. Then we have Kerala. It started with beginning of the 18th century, divided among a large number of feudal chiefs. Foremost were Calicut under Zamorin, Chirakkal, Cochin and Travancore. And the kingdom of Travancore rose into prominence after 1729 under King Mantanda Varma. Then he combined rare foresight, determination, courage, daring, subdued the feudatories, Ceylon. And these are all what is about Kerala. If you just go through it, if you read it once, you will know that yes, man, it's very simple and very clear. Then we have areas around Delhi. How did they emerge? The Rajput states. And then this is all about Jaipur that we have. That how Raja Man Singh, and that is why you'll see the World Heritage Site has also now taken Jaipur as a consideration as a site. And then we also have the Jat state here. Then we have here the Bangash, Pathans and Rohilas, the Sikhs, and how did they emerge, how did they involve themselves in a part of this 18th century rise. And then we have the rise and fall of Maratha, which we'll do in the next video, along with Marathas, their features, their characters, and the Anglo-Maratha war. This is it with today's video.